Good afternoon, if it's afternoon where you are. This is Eric Coffin, co-editor of the HRA Advisories, speaking to you from the Agoracom Online Golden Commodities Conference. I'm going to talk today about how interest rates and currency differentials are driving the metals and the equities markets. We all remember what this looks like. You probably don't want to think about it, but this is the starting point for what's happened over the past year. And other than the fact that it's kind of amusing, it bottomed at 666. I don't really want to go into it either. Once we got that, then we got this. That, of course, was the central bank's response to the crisis, the most massive liquidity injections in history, not only in the U.S., but in the Bank of England, several of the central banks and the ECB in Europe, and, of course, the central bank in China. The U.S. and the Bank of England also added to those liquidity injections by doing quantitative easing, which essentially is them going directly into the bond market as bond market participants, buying basically crappy debt and buying their own treasuries and gilts in order to hold interest rates down. Of course, the tail of all of this will be an extended period of large fiscal deficits virtually across the G7. We expect all countries to be running fairly large ones for several years. That helped to give us this, which of course is a very nice bounce, and I think it's almost getting beyond the point where you can really call it a bounce in the S&P index and essentially all of the major indices since the beginning of March. We've got about a 60% increase now. So now what? Essentially what's happened most recently is you've got two things going on. One is that you have traders parking money in the bond market because there still are a lot of people that are concerned and nervous about the underlying situation. There's still a lot of problems out there. The combination of that plus a low target rate and the quantitative easing by the Fed means that we've got historically low interest rates across the entire G7. The Fed announced recently that it would stop doing these bond purchases, the TARP program. But interestingly, the bond market took this in its stride, and short-term treasury rates are actually lower now than they were when that announcement was made. That tells us a couple of things. One, that people are still nervous, and two, that we don't see a short-term expectation of inflation. But I would not underestimate how powerful that stimulus is. The chart on this slide is a good graphic indication of what the Fed and bond market participants have done over the last year. It's a set of treasury yield curves. The pink ones, the lower ones, if you will, are recent ones from late October. The green one with the small triangles is from October 2008. As you can see here, the short end of the curve, as it's called, from 1 month to 2 years has been pushed down, so it's almost at zero, going from basically 1 month notes to 1 year notes. Are now down to about 30 or 40 basis points at the one-year level. That's an incredibly strong stimulus, and that's the effect of both the Fed itself buying those short-term notes to raise prices and drop the yield, and also from bond market participants. There's still lots of people parking money in here because they're not sure what's coming next. What that's generated, and you'll see this on the next graph, this is a 10-year chart that compares the consumer price index in the U.S. and one-year treasury constant maturity rates. The maturity rates are the red line that you see. The blue line is the CPI, essentially. In places, and I've shown two of them in ovals, where the red line is dropping below the blue line, that means real interest rates are negative. Negative real interest rates are normally seen when central banks are behind the curve. One example of that, of course, is back early in this decade when Greenspan was felt to be behind the curve and let rates stay low for too long. You usually see it in periods of rising inflation. It's an extremely strong stimulus, both for the equity markets and for commodities. If you go back through decades, through centuries, you'll find that the periods where commodities tended to perform the best and hard assets performed the best were also periods where you had negative real interest rates. To give you an example of how powerful that's been, because of the negative rates, but also because of the secular commodity bull market that Dave and I have talked about for years. Here's a chart that goes back to 2000 of the CRB Commodity Index. You'll note that we've drawn a line where the index bottomed right at the start of this year. That 2008-2009 low is 60% above the 2002 low. This is one of the reasons why we've been saying for years this is not just a bubble in the middle of this decade. This is, in fact, a secular bull market in commodities. So how do we fare going forward? Based on what we've seen so far, we're fairly comfortable that the U.S. and most of Europe is, in fact, climbing out of this recession, but it's not coming out of it strong. We don't think the U.S. economy will fare better than most of the rest of the G7 over the next few years. It's probably going to come in about average, and it might even be a little bit weaker. Because of that, our expectation is the Fed's going to hold its rates down longer than the ECB, maybe longer than the Bank of England, certainly longer than what we call the creditor economies like Canada, China, Australia. Australia, of course, has already moved rates up a couple of times. One of the largest determinants and predictors of forward currency rates is, in fact, interest rate, real interest rate differentials. With negative interest rates in the U.S. going forward, that's a big negative for the U.S. dollar. We don't think that's really an issue for the U.S. It's actually to their advantage to have a weak currency. We know there's a lot of political hand-wringing about it, and people worry about the dollar not being strong. Given the situation the U.S. is in right now, the best thing that can happen to them is to have their currency get weaker. The only time it really becomes a big issue is if that weakening currency drives people out of their bond market and you see interest rates start to climb rapidly because people just stop buying their debt. As I noted earlier, yields have actually been falling in the U.S., so that certainly is an issue right now. And as long as it isn't, we don't see any particular reason for the dollar to go up or for currency traders to be long on it. Here's a graphic example, of course. You're taking a look here at the U.S. dollar index. This chart goes back 2 years. It dropped down to the low during the tail end of the last cycle at just below 71. Of course, it ran up dramatically in the second half of last year. It topped out just about the same time that the equity markets bottomed out. It's now back to 74.23. Now, I've drawn a line there that goes across to the lows of last fall, and I think that's an important level. It's clearly well below that level right now, technically, and a lot of currency traders are chart traders. The next low would be down in the 70-71 level. If we see a move that low over the next few months, that's extremely bullish for commodities, but particularly for hard assets and particularly for precious metals. This, of course, is a chart I'm sure you've all looked at. If you're even bothering to be sitting here listening to this, you know what this chart looks like. Here's a gold chart. This one goes back also a couple of years. You can clearly see the new highs. This is a gold and U.S. dollar chart, but I would point out, and it's important to point out, that in the last couple of weeks, gold has in fact made new highs across several major currencies. And if I was to put up a 10-year chart of this, you've all seen it, so I won't bother. It's an even more clear and definitive secular bull market in gold. There's no doubt right now that a big part of this trade in gold and definitely in base metals is what I would call an anti-dollar trade. It's a currency trade, not just a commodity trade. Gold itself, we feel, is trading both as a currency and as a neutral asset. One of the reasons why you're seeing highs across several different currencies is it's not just a vote against the dollar. It's a vote of non-confidence against a lot of essentially stupid and disliked government moves and concerns that governments in general are just going to start trying to outspend each other but also out-debase each other when it comes to their currencies. I mean, we saw news overnight that Japan was backing off. They were going to try to do some things to make the yen weaker. It didn't really work, but when you see that sort of thing happening, I mean, all of these currencies move against gold. So although gold's had a big run and you've got to look for some pullbacks, I don't think we're done yet by any means in this gold market. Base metals, the same thing is true. Copper especially is actually a better inflation hedge if that's what your concern is, but the currency moves are a big factor.